Morning, everybody.
Morning.
Everybody happy to be here this morning. We have a lot of visitors, and we're certainly thankful for your being here. And even with all the ones we have, I still know there are several who were going to be here but couldn't be because of illnesses and various other things. So as absolutely incredible as this is, we could have had more had we had some who are regularly here, but because of sick children and other things, could not be. But we are so excited and honored for Rebecca. Excited and honored for your presence, and we're thankful for your being here. We have people from Mississippi to Morrilton to everywhere in between. So please stay after we're done worshiping here in about 25 or 30 minutes or so, and eat with us. We have an amazing spread prepared for us all, and a very well decorated fellowship hall just across the hallway. So please stay and eat with us, and then worship with us again. About 1:15, 1:30, you'll see us all moseying back in here, and then we'll have another sermon then. We have been promoting this particular Sunday since last year's Homecoming Sunday. As I've said a few times already, we've been averaging about 60 or so that last year, and then we had a goal for 100, and we had it 166 on Homecoming. We've been averaging about 80. Our goal was 200 this Homecoming. I don't know what we have. I know this place seats about 240. We might, this might maybe have reached our goal, but it doesn't matter whether we did or didn't. That's just for our own sake to know that or not. But thank you for making this special day, as every Lord's Day is special, an extra special Lord's Day. I've been saying for months that on Homecoming Sunday I would preach a sermon because I knew the meal was going to be waiting and calling our names, like in the cartoons, the smell just wafting in here. So I've been saying for a long time that the sermon I'm going to preach would be short, sweet, and to the point. So I guess I better get started before anyone gets upset. So let's see. Short. Life is short. Psalm 89, 47 and 48. Remember how short my time is. Where you have made all men vain. What man is he that lives and shall not see death? Shall he deliver his soul from the hand of the grave? Life is short. It can be accelerated. It cannot be avoided. Death is coming. Life is a fleeting thing. Moses wrote Psalm 90 and says that the days of our years are about 3 score years and 10, or about 70 years. That's the average lifespan of a person. Now, it might be a little bit more than that now because of medicine and such things, but more or less, it's about 70 years. But even that is not guaranteed either. All things being equal, maybe 70 years, but David very famously lost a son right after birth. We have had some people who live to be 120 years old, and they're just still kicking. They smoke 2 packs a day. Nothing seems to stop them. Everybody lives different ages. Nevertheless, we are not guaranteed more time. You get the time that you get, and you won't throw a fit. That's just what it is. You're not guaranteed anything more than what you have for as long as you have it. Time is a fleeting thing. James 4, 13 through 15. James speaks of those who would arrogantly say, "I'll live my life my way, thank you, I don't need God." Go to now you that say, "Today, tomorrow, we'll go into such a city, we'll buy and sell and get gain. For you don't know what will be on the morrow. What is your life? It is but a vapor, gone. Your life is a vapor, it's here today and it's gone tomorrow. It passes away, appears for a little time and then it's gone. You ought to say, if the Lord will, because your life is not in your hands. You ought to say, if the Lord will, we will do this or that. If God's will is that I live to see tomorrow, if I live to see an hour from now, if the Lord wills." Luke 12, 16 through 20, Jesus spoke a parable about a rich man who, again, like James spoke of, thought he had it all under control. Well, you have many things under your control. Your life is not under your control. He spoke a parable unto them, saying, "The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. And he thought within himself," this rich man did, "and said, what shall I do? Oh, problem of problems, I have nowhere to bestow all my fruits." And he said, "This I will do. I'll tear down my barns, and I'll build bigger barns, and I'll say to my soul, so you have much good stored up for many years. Take your easy, drink and be merry." You know, there's a saying, "Eat, drink, and be merry." It tends to end with, "For tomorrow we may die." You know where that saying came from? Jesus, because the rich man said, "Eat, drink, and be merry." That's where he stopped. But then God said, "You fool, this night your soul will be required of you. You're going to die tomorrow. And while you're eating, drinking, and having fun, you're missing out on the fact that God is supposed to be in control." That rich man, that rich farmer, thought he had everything. You know what he didn't have? Time. Life is short. The triumph of the wicked is short. Job 20, verse 4 and 5. This is Zophar, one of Job's friends, talking to Job, and he says, "Do you not know this of old, that since man was placed upon the earth, that the triumphing of the wicked is short, and the joy of the hypocrite is but for a moment?" Now, typically, when you read the book of Job, it's really a conversation between Job and Job's three friends, who are trying to convince Job just how bad he is. Job has to defend himself and his character and the character of God. Nevertheless, on this occasion, what this friend Zophar says is absolutely right. The triumph of the wicked is but for a season. The triumph of the wicked, the rejoicing evil people have, is but for a short time. It's short. Now, when we talk about how life is short, we tend to say it in the negative. Oh no, life is short. I'm only here for a little while. But think about it. Your life is full of wicked people. Your life is full of evil things. Your life is full of heartache and pain and temptation to do wicked things. So when we think around us, and we look at the world around us, and we say, everything around us is evil. It's only getting worse. It might seem like that. Maybe it is only getting worse. But remember, for the amount of time while you're on this earth and wicked people are prospering is but a drop in the bucket compared to how long a righteous person will live in the presence of God forever and ever. Oh, but wicked people have been wicked for 6,000 years. Yes, but when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we'll have no less days to sing His praise than when we first begun. The triumph of the wicked is short. Therefore, your Bible tells you repeatedly, stop giving in to this need for vengeance. We talked about the nature of God in class, what defines God as God. Let God be the God of wrath. You don't get to be. Romans 12:19-21. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves. Rather, give place, set it aside, your wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, you feed him. If he is thirsty, you give him drink, because in doing so, you heap coals of fire on his head. You put out the flame of hostility between you and him. Be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good. Beautiful play on words. Since life is short, time is running out on the wicked. Reach out to the wicked. Give them a hand of mercy, not wrath. You might help them because his life is short too. The triumph of the wicked is short. Man has come short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and just missed the glory of God. Before you get all high and mighty, before I start thinking how wonderful I am, how wicked everyone is around me, like the Pharisees of old, with their noses in the air, their eyes looking down just smugly on everyone around them, before you forget that you were once a sinner, if you're a Christian now, before you forget that you are still a sinner, if you're not a Christian yet, remember, we've all come short, just missed the glory of God. The expression implies, you can hear it, the visual in your brain. If you think visually, you can close your eyes and picture a person reaching out to attain something, but he just can't reach it. He can stretch and stretch and stretch, but he can't quite grab it. He's this close, but this close is not enough. You can see the glory of God. You can see the grace of Jesus Christ. You can see the salvation available, but you on your own cannot reach it. You can reach it, reach it, reach out for it, but you cannot take it alone. There's a gap. The gap may be so, but it's still a gap, and you can't close the deal. You have come short. I have come short. I cannot justify myself. I can't find it. I cannot redeem myself. I can't buy it. I need Jesus Christ. Romans 3, the whole context of that. Romans 3:10-18, as it is written, there is none righteous. No, not one without Jesus. There is none that understands, none that seeks after God. They're all gone out of the way. They're all become unprofitable. There's none that does good. No, not one. No, their throat is an open sepulchre. They say it's dead, rotting, grave words. With their tongue they use deceit. The poison of asp, snakes, is on their lips. Whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. When they run somewhere, it's to do evil things, he says. Destruction and misery are their ways. The way of peace they don't know. There's no fear of God in their eyes. These are wicked people going down a path of wickedness, and their time is short, and then it comes destruction. Wicked, 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 wicked. It's all around us, he says. And then we've all sinned. We're all wicked without God. We've all come short of the glory of God. But then he says, being justified, Christians, justified freely by his blood, we have found redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Oh, but you don't have to be wicked. You can be saved. You can stay in God's glory. You can bridge the gap between where your finger inches and where God's hand is. You can bridge the gap with Jesus Christ. How wide is the gap between me and God? It's about this wide. It's the gap of about a 6-foot-tall man hanging on a cross. And he bridged the gap. He took my hand in one. He took God's hand in the other. And he connected the two. I need Christ on the hill. That's what he offers. Without him, though, just missed him. Now, that's short. Let's talk about sweet. The Word of God is sweet. Psalm 19:10. Psalm 119:103. Let's start at Psalm 19:9-10. The fear of the Lord is clean. enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired than gold, yes, but let's keep to the food. More fine gold, yes, but then he says, sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. Oh, I love honey. I can eat it on bread. I can eat it on a sandwich. I can eat honey. If I could eat it in cereal, I would eat it in cereal. They make the Honey Toast Crunch, so I guess I can't eat it in cereal. I love honey. I just eat honey, and you can tell how much I love honey. I'm like Winnie the Pooh. I love honey so much. Listen to the word. God is sweeter than the sweetest honey from the nicest honeycomb. When you have a taste, a sampling of the bread of life, when you have just an inkling of the water of life that flows from Calvary's Hill, your soul will cry out for more. You know what's interesting about honey? I guess all sugar. Listen, somebody please, not now, but when we get done, explain to me why. Why do they wrap those Hershey Kisses individually? They know I'm not going to eat just one. Why do they wrap them individually? I don't know, but they ought to not do that because it saves me a lot of time. Because when you take sugar and you put sugar in your body, a short-term chemical reaction happens. Your brain sends a signal to the rest of your body that says, I think I'll have seconds. You cannot just eat one Hershey Kiss because your brain says, I want more. Chocolate just does something to your brain that makes you want it again, and then want it again, and then want it again. And as you can see, sometimes it just never stops. That's what chocolate does. That's what honey does. Listen, when you take the Word of God into your heart will say, seconds, please. When you take the bread of life, your brain will say, give me more. Someone loved me enough to die for me. That message is sweet. Fellowship with brethren is sweet. Psalm 133:1. Behold how good and pleasant, how nice, how endearing, how sweet it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Just pause. Everyone just look around. Look at this crowd. There's barely a seat available where you're not elbowing somebody else. Look at this crowd. How wonderful it is when people get together in a room to worship God. People are doing it all over the world. But how nice is it under our roof? And everybody can say that under their own roof, but we're here, so let's talk about us. How wonderful is it that we can get under our roof and have almost a packed house, a parking lot full, and people in the yard worshiping God, the Christ-loving people. I didn't have a verse that used the word sweet, but it's there. Good and pleasant. You can say it. Sweet. When brethren dwell together. I want unity with every person who loves Jesus Christ. I want to be united with every person that loves God the Father, Christ the Son He sent, the Holy Spirit that inspired this beautiful, sweet-tasting book. I want unity with everybody. I don't get to define unity, of course. You don't get to define unity, we understand. God defines unity. God's at the top of the triangle. I'm over here. My brother in Christ is over here. God's at the top. And He dictates who I have fellowship with. But I want unity. It's only found in Jesus Christ. It's only found with Jesus Christ. It's only found by Jesus Christ. It's only found to Jesus Christ. How sweet it is, though, when it's found. Listen, we'll always be in the minority. Jesus said there is a broad, big way that leads to destruction. At camp, in Camp Condal, where I've been going for a long time, there's a way that goes down to the lake. I've heard about it. But there's a way that goes down to the lake. There's a big, big gate. And there's also a small little way that is more scary. When I was young, we took this small, dangerous, you're practically, spelunking to get to that thing. But now they've opened a big path. That's what I always thought of when I read that. There's a big, wide way. There's a nice, easy path. There's a smaller, more treacherous, more difficult way. Jesus says everybody who's going to heaven is only going to get there by taking that small, you're in the minority, narrow way. You're going to be in the minority. But on occasions like this, it feels nice, doesn't it? When you're with a lot of people who love Jesus Christ, how sweet it is when brethren dwell together in unity. How sweet 'twill be to meet the Lord when He comes in glory by and by. 1 Thessalonians 4:13-17. Context, these Christians at Thessalonica thought, oh, the Lord's about to return. My mother has died, my brother has died, my son has died. They're just going to miss Jesus because I know Jesus is coming by the end of the first century. That's what they thought. They're misunderstood. So Paul has to write to say, no, get back to work, sir. Evangelizing. Jesus is going to come eventually. Eventually doesn't mean immediately. He's coming eventually. But they thought, oh, I'm going to miss it. If I die, I'm going to miss the resurrection and the second coming. So Paul says, listen, it will be sweet when it happens. You'll meet the Lord. 1 Thessalonians 4:13. I don't want you to be ignorant, brethren, about those who are asleep, dead in Christ. And I want you to sorrow like those who have no hope sorrow when a loved one who's not a Christian dies. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, then you want to believe that those who are dead will rise with Him and God bring with Him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with the Lord to meet Him in the air, We will not prevent those who are asleep, but Jesus will return from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then we which are alive and remain will be caught up to meet Him. How sweet it will be to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with Him. What about us? Assuming we're alive when He returns, we've got all of us probably can think of somebody who has gone before us, who has died, be it a mother, a father, an old friend, somebody who has left this world. And we think, oh, I wish I could see them again. Yes, but I want to see them there. How sweet it will be, not just to be reunited with my Master, whom I've never laid eyes on, but to be reunited with my family in Christ, who are long in this, who have left me. It's been 2,000 years. It might be another 2,000 years. It could be another 50,000 years. We could be colonizing other planets. My descendants could be on Mars for all I know, but I know when He returns, the sky will split, the universe will break open, and Christ will return. How sweet will that be when He comes? Heaven. Heaven is our sweet land. That's where He's taking us. Heaven is our sweet land of milk and honey. The old land of Canaan. Exodus 3:8. God says, I'm come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them up out of the land, into a good land, and a large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Well, it didn't literally have honey waterfalls and milk waterfalls. It just means it's a land cultivated and ready for you to jump in and take over. It's ready for you now. It's flowing with everything you ever need, milk and honey. But the symbolism is there, and it's so much greater when you apply it to the second Canaan. To Canaan's land, I'm on my way. Don't we sing that song? That is not the land in Palestine. I'm on my way to the greater Canaan. The greater Moses is taking me there. The greater Joshua is conquering my enemies to let me take that land. I'm going to heaven someday. Revelation 14:13. I heard a voice, John said, from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, says the Spirit, they shall rest from their labors. What was Canaan? O land of rest for thee I sigh. They'll rest from their labors and their works. You follow them. He's coming back. He's coming to take us home. And it will be a sweet homecoming. Look, is this not a sweet homecoming? Nothing. Compared to what is awaiting us. I told you it would be short. I told you it would be sweet. Before we close, let's get to the point. What's the point? What do you mean when you say the point? Well, there's point like the point of a nail. John 19:18. But the kind of nail that was driven into my Master's hands, and the kind of nail that was driven into His feet as He screamed like a man in agony was in pain. There's that kind of a point. What do you mean when you say point? Well, maybe it's like the point of a spear driven into His side which shed the blood of Christ. Maybe it's that kind of a spear. I need that kind of a spear, this word, that gives me contact with the blood of Christ when I obey it. Maybe it's point, like you say, what's the point? What's the point of it all? What's the point of this sermon? What's the point of that message? You ever just hear a preacher preach, hopefully it's not right now, and you think, what's the point of this? I'm not following Him. What's the point? What's the point of the gospel? What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? He died. He was buried. He rose again for you. He died for you. He was buried for you. He rose for you. That's the gospel. What's the point? What am I supposed to do with that information? Just acknowledge the facts of it? Obviously, the facts of it are true. Nothing else makes sense. Come back this afternoon. I'll explain that. Obviously, Jesus died and rose again, but what am I supposed to do with that information? I'm supposed to do something with it? What's the point of the gospel, Romans 6, 3-7? Don't you know that so many of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into His death? And we are buried with Him by baptism into death. And like as Jesus was raised up from the glory of the Father, we are raised to walk in newness of life. Because if we've been planted, buried together in the likeness of His death, we shall be resurrected in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with Him. The body of sin is destroyed. Henceforth, we no longer serve sin, as He that is dead is freed from sin. What's the point? The point is you need to become a Christian. Are you a Christian? If you're not, listen to me, life is short. If you're not a Christian, you might be the best person in your neighborhood, but you're doing wickedness in the sight of God, and that life that you live is short-lived. Taste the sweet message of the gospel. Obey and be saved. If you're a fallen away Christian, oh, don't let go of the hand of Christ. You come short of the glory of God again. There's a sweet land of rest waiting for you. If we can help you find it, let us know what we need to do right now as we stand and say.